Welcome to Value-Based Care, Volume 2 Value. This is Lecture D, Coding in Value-Based Payment Models. This lecture covers the concepts related to reasons why capturing data correctly is essential for both compensation and quality care initiatives. It also discusses the considerations around who enters data and why efficient workflow and use of resources is required. Finally, this lecture discusses the legal and ethical issues related to proper coding. The objective for this lecture is to discuss how proper clinical documentation supports reimbursement for the cost of delivering care. This lecture discusses concepts related to capturing data for healthcare now that most healthcare providers have moved from paper records to electronic health records, or EHRs. We'll explore why it is essential to collect accurate data for both compensation and quality care initiatives. We'll also explore the considerations around who enters data and why efficient workflow and use of resources is required. Finally, we'll explore both the legal and ethical issues related to proper coding. It's important to start with a discussion of why data is important in value-based care. Value-based contracts have elements that require meeting quality standards for the care being delivered. These quality measures are an essential safeguard against attempts to manipulate the system. Healthcare providers could attempt to save money in ways that would result in potentially providing lower quality care. This will be discussed more in Unit 7 when we explore the difference between the HMO and ACO models. To help ensure that there isn't over or underutilization of healthcare services, accurate measures for care quality are a core element of value-based payment contracts. Quality measures consist of the numerators and denominators necessary to run accurate statistical calculations and are supported by logic. Certified EHRs provide the platform to capture and report on the data used to determine payments based on quality measurements. They do this first by capturing the numerators and denominators properly and accurately, based on the information entered into the patient record. Then they allow the providers to report and the payer organizations to receive reports that accurately reflect changes in the calculated quality measure. These data elements are pre-identified numbers gathered from individual patients. This allows both provider and payer groups to identify overall trends and improvements in patient outcomes, such as improvements in achieving diabetes quality measures. Additional features of Certified Electronic Health Record Technology, or CEHRT, as well as other health IT tools, including data aggregation and population management solutions, enable providers to more accurately see how their patients are doing, both individually and as an attributed or assigned population. This allows providers to identify opportunities to improve quality, such as changing a workflow to include an alert within the EHR to help ensure that all women in a certain age range receive regular cervical cancer screenings in order to meet a quality measure related to that screening. Beyond the basic principles of coding, the next issue to address concerns coding in a value-based system. The number of payment codes has expanded significantly to support value-based payments. Payers are increasingly introducing payment codes to encourage the transition away from fee-for-service payments. Payers also encourage providers to coordinate care and cover wellness visits. Following the passage of the Affordable Care Act, in 2011, the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, or CMS, pays physicians for the initial preventative physical exam, or IPPE, which is also known as the Welcome to Medicare Preventative Visit. In addition to that initial Medicare visit, Medicare pays for an annual wellness visit, where the provider can do an overall health assessment and document any issues regarding the patient's health. The Affordable Care Act also required commercial plans to cover more preventative services without copays. Covering these services are based on a belief that providing better primary or preventative care consistently will lead to healthier outcomes and produce healthcare savings for both the patient and the payer over time. Another key to controlling costs involves providing payment during transitions of care. These transitions occur when a patient is discharged from a hospital, either to her home or to a nursing home, or when a patient moves between multiple specialists. In the past, there was no payment for managing these transitions. They were often neglected, and as a result, patients did not always get the care that was appropriate for them, which put them at risk for becoming sicker and ultimately costing the system more money. As an acknowledgement of these issues, care transitions are key elements in value-based contracts, and in 2013, CMS introduced codes that allow providers to manage care transitions. Now providers can bill Medicare for time spent making sure that the patient's care transitions are smoother and that all of the appropriate information is transferred. Chronic care management is extremely relevant to Medicare. Approximately two-thirds of Medicare beneficiaries have two or more chronic conditions. Of that group, one-third of them have four or more chronic conditions. To improve quality and control cost, providing an incentive to manage those with chronic conditions makes sense. It is better for everyone if those patients can stay out of the hospital, but it can be challenging to achieve that goal. In 2015, payment codes were introduced for chronic care management. These codes served as an acknowledgement that people with two or more chronic illnesses require a different kind of healthcare coordination. For example, this might involve a patient with Alzheimer's disease and another condition like arthritis, asthma, depression, or osteoporosis. These diseases are complex to manage, often cause patients considerable limitations, complications, or suffering, and they often incur high healthcare costs if not carefully managed. Payments for chronic care management are a small step in the direction of supporting value-based care. In July 2015, CMS announced it was going to develop codes so that physicians could bill for having discussions with patients about end-of-life care. Effective January 2016, physicians can bill Medicare for having discussions with patients about end-of-life care. This end-of-life rule, introducing a new code, allows 30 minutes for an initial advanced care planning conversation, then an additional 30 minutes of follow-up that can happen in the same year. In a poll by the Kaiser Family Foundation, 89% of patient respondents said that physicians should discuss end-of-life care issues with their patients. Unfortunately, just 17% said that they have had such discussions with their physician. Physicians believe that they should have these conversations, and the public believes these conversations should take place, but if there's no mechanism to pay for them, they won't happen. By creating a code for end-of-life discussions, physicians or other healthcare staff can take time to have these important conversations. Another concern about the transition from the fee-for-service model to a value-based care model is that this new model can seriously affect the profitability of clinics and hospitals. There are a number of reasons for this. First, because there are so many new requirements for documentation associated with value-based care, physicians, nurses, and healthcare providers are spending more time on documentation than before, when they didn't need to worry as much about providing a very precise level of documentation to get paid. A second reason is related to the value-based modifier, which provides for differential payment to a physician or group of physicians under the current Medicare physician fee schedule. These differential payments are based upon the quality of care furnished compared to cost during a performance period. In other words, it's an adjustment made on a per-claim basis to Medicare payments for items and services under the Medicare fee schedule. This program is being rolled into MIPS, as discussed in Unit 6, Lecture B, so we will have to see how the MACRA final rule addresses it. A key component of the MIPS is an adjustment in payments based on value, so some providers will lose a percentage of their billings, and others will gain a percentage of their billing based on their MIPS composite performance score, starting in 2019. A third reason concerns the limited revenue associated with some of the newer codes. Even though CMS and other payers are starting to allow providers to bill for certain activities, such as chronic care management, the payments can be low considering the amount of work and effort required. Using the example of chronic care management, providers are currently allowed to bill only $42 per patient per month to perform these services. To provide this service at this level of reimbursement, clinics and hospitals need to create new workflows, new staffing roles, and new processes and procedures to improve efficiency and profitability. Improving efficiency and profitability in a value-based care system may involve rethinking who does what and ensuring that all members of the care team are working at the top of their license. For example, for many years, advanced practice registered nurses or nurse practitioners have provided some types of care, such as tests that less expensive staff could do. Many clinics and hospitals are starting to reorganize the way work is done so that a medical assistant executes certain elements of the process, such as taking a patient's blood pressure or gathering some of the patient's health information. Then higher-paid staff performs the parts of the process that require a higher level of knowledge or license. This is especially true for care coordination. For example, if a physician has to spend extensive time on the phone relaying patient information to another physician group in order to coordinate care, it becomes very expensive. Often, much of this communication could be done electronically or by a less expensive staff member. By using the right level of staff to communicate the right information, physician time is spent as efficiently as possible, such as in critical conversations that require a physician-to-patient conversation. Medical personnel trends show the emergence of new roles in clinics and healthcare organizations, such as care manager and patient advocate, because their work can be billed appropriately for their services. A practice-level modeling study to compare chronic care management delivery approaches indicated that practices that rely on non-physician team members to deliver chronic care management will probably experience a substantial net revenue gain. On the other hand, if they use only physicians to do chronic care management, the study indicated that they would lose revenue. But even with a substantial net revenue gain, it turns out that the payment amounts are not sufficient when a hospital or clinic is not performing these services for a significant number of patients. There are efficiencies in working with large numbers of patients and using lower-cost staff to perform routine procedures. Before discussing the cost of care and how it relates to medical coding, let's define some terms. There are two big coding groups utilized by care providers. Current procedural terminology, or CPT codes, are a copyrighted set of codes that are used for the billing. International Classification of Disease, or ICD, is an international medical classification list that applies to the diagnosis of disease. 2015 began the implementation of ICD-10 coding. These new standard diagnosis codes replaced ICD-9. ICD-10 allows for more specific and complete information within a single code. Additionally, ICD-10 codes are updated to reflect advances in medical knowledge and technology, thereby allowing a better indication of what conditions and care were addressed. This coding system supports healthcare outcomes by providing the ability for healthcare providers to better link patient needs to the value of the healthcare delivered. These codes also support moving away from paying for activity and moving towards paying for value, which is defined as achieving health outcomes that matter to patients, that is, having longer and healthier lives, relative to the cost of achieving those outcomes. In developing systems that measure the value of healthcare, it's very important to segment the information and to make sure that the full story about patients and the care they receive is reported. For example, consider the cost and quality of care that's necessary for a child who has mild asthma and uses an inhaler before he plays sports, and a child who ends up frequently hospitalized because he has severe asthma that is difficult to manage. Both of the children have asthma. However, the health data for each child is very different because one has severe, uncontrolled asthma, while the other has mild, controlled asthma. The new value-based payment models depend on key factors like severity-adjusted data. It's also important to see whether quality initiatives have an impact on a patient or a patient population. Having the ability to tie quality initiatives to the severity of the disease becomes important. Finally, questions about patient safety and the ethical assignment of codes and billing all have to do with understanding not only general information about the patient, but specific information too. The most important thing that ICD-10 codes have done is bring much more granularity to the diagnosis of disease. The first chart shows that from an analysis of over 15 million claims in one insurance company's system, 50% came in with very general, non-specific codes. Building a learning health system that allows for an understanding of the severity of disease, the types of disease present, and what procedures, medicines, or practices actually help resolve those diseases requires specificity. ICD-10 provides this level of granularity. The second chart shows the old ICD-9 code for angioplasty, or doing a heart procedure to clear out a clot. In ICD-9, there was only one code for angioplasty. Under ICD-10, there are 5 codes, which allow for much greater specificity. For example, we can code whether the stent placed during the angioplasty procedure was a drug-eluting device, that is, a stent that allows additional medicine to the bloodstream, or that it was a standard non-drug-eluting stent. Having the ability to record very specifically what was done facilitates the understanding of the outcomes associated with different forms of devices and different procedures. This is the reason that ICD-10 plays a role in the transition to value-based care. Roles and responsibilities for coding have changed and will continue to change as the U.S. moves to value-based care. Increasingly, the option of health IT and certified electronic health records technology plays a role too. Nonetheless, despite all these new tools and new ways to pay for healthcare, the foundation of any healthcare practice is the accuracy of coding. That process begins with provider documentation. In the world of medicine, the people who are highly skilled and highly trained in diagnosing disease are physicians or advanced practice registered nurses. Coding properly requires clinical knowledge. The responsibility for proper coding of a diagnosis, therefore, starts with the providers. The best practice is for a healthcare provider to learn to effectively use the EHR and to gradually eliminate handwritten notes and even dictation and other systems that require transcription. Any step that moves away from the provider documenting the disease introduces opportunities for mistake. Those should be eliminated. In many practices, this might require some process re-engineering, because computerized physician order entry, where the physician documents the diagnosis, has still not been implemented. There needs to be ongoing re-engineering to make sure that coding is done by those who are most responsible. The American Health Information Management Association, or AHIMA, recommends a classic Plan-Do-Study-Act, or PDSA cycle, where initially there is an assessment of the current workflow and map of roles and responsibilities within the clinic or hospital. Then, a future state is designed, with clear indication of where documentation should take place, what should be documented, and by whom. The next step is to set realistic goals for the transition, and then set realistic expectations and guidelines for implementing that new solution. The implementation of electronic health records has created some new issues. Some of these issues are simply associated with not knowing the right way to document what. Some go beyond just documentation and involve potential ethical issues. The ethical issues involve actually trying to defraud a system or a payer in order to get paid for more than what the care team has done. This can involve EHR systems that are programmed to ensure that a procedure is coded at the highest possible level of billing. In fee-for-service systems, the same type of procedure can be billed at a higher level or for more money if the patient is sicker or if more steps were taken in the procedure. Computerized algorithms can be built to monitor a physician's coding behavior. With prompts and alerts, the electronic record system can bring up recommendations to encourage the physician to either do more work so that there is more pay, or to click boxes or select menu items that trigger higher-paying billing codes. This is completely legitimate only if the higher level of care is needed and is provided. On the other hand, when a provider sees a patient who requires a lower level of screening, the EHR can help ensure important steps aren't missed. A classic example would be a mammogram. For certain women, depending on the latest best practice guidelines, the provider might neglect to recommend that they complete this important screening. However, the computer system can prompt the provider to remind the patient of the screening, and the provider clinic who performs the screening is then paid for that screening. This is completely appropriate and is actually a great use of the power of the EHR to make sure that high-quality care is provided. It's also legitimate in cases where providers do procedures but don't remember to document them. A good example of this is a teen clinic that was giving immunizations. It turned out that the billing system required two procedures to be clicked, one for doing the exam associated with providing the immunization, and one for giving the immunization. Providers were only clicking the box that indicated they had done the immunization. Thus, they were paid less when it was completely legitimate for them to be paid for the complete value of that visit, which included an exam and then the immunization. In this case, the computer system captured a failure of documentation and reminded the providers to do the right thing. When providers use the copy and paste feature of an EHR, it is called cloning. By using this feature, they don't actually document what they did during an encounter. Instead, they have a block of text they cut from one record and paste into another. This is both unethical and dangerous for patients. One provider pointed out in an article that she had seen these words: "A patient is on day 2 of antibiotics, appears for 5 days in a row in one chart." As she said, "Worse, I've seen my own assessments of a patient's health appear in another physician's notes." These are clearly cases where proper documentation practices were not followed. Failing to document accurately and honestly in an EHR is unethical, and it's obviously dangerous for a patient if her health record includes information that isn't correct. This can result in all sorts of medical errors. It can also be potentially fraudulent if the information pasted in the record causes the provider to be paid for procedures that weren't performed. A second possible misuse of health records is related to the ability of the EHR system to run algorithms, resulting in recommendations regarding additional services that could be attached to other procedures and would allow the provider to get paid more. This is different from the earlier example that showed how the system could help make sure the provider is paid for both the exam and the immunization. This is sometimes called upcoding, and it means using the EHR to charge for services that weren't performed. Obviously, this is fraudulent. A number of studies of billing, particularly hospital billing, have been done and have stoked fears that unethical practices are widespread. When payers saw a big increase in billing shortly after the implementation of EHRs, this also raised a red flag. One assumes that the actual work that went on in the hospital or clinic didn't change that rapidly. This concern rose to the national level after articles appeared documenting this behavior. Secretary of Health and Human Services Kathleen Sebelius and Attorney General Eric Holder released the following statement: "There are troubling indications that some providers are using this technology to game the system, possibly to obtain payments to which they are not entitled." They also point out that false documentation of care is not just bad patient care, it's illegal. Further, one might point out it is also highly unethical. There are recommendations for avoiding misuse. First, an organization needs to make sure that there are policies and procedures in place that explicitly refer to these practices and make it clear that they are wrong. Secondly, training is very important. There are cases where seemingly innocent clicks can result in fraudulent billing or mistaken documentation. Organizations should ensure that providers know how to use the system correctly so that they are not exposed to those kinds of risks. Finally, organizations that are interested in eliminating this sort of behavior can employ audit functions to look for abuses. As a society, it is important to be aware that there are organizations that encourage illegitimate and unethical uses of EHR systems to make more money. For cases where this happens, there is hope that the warnings from the Attorney General and the Secretary of Health and Human Services would have an effect, because this is illegal behavior and unethical. When working in a hospital or clinic, should someone become concerned about the actions of a provider or concerned that his organization may be promoting behaviors that are improper, it is important to make sure that he and everyone within the organization understands that these actions have ethical and legal implications. Electronic health record systems do have strong auditing functions. Any EHR system can quickly show who did what, and patterns of behavior can be exposed. This concludes Lecture D of Volume to Value. This lecture introduced concepts related to reasons why capturing data correctly is essential for both compensation and quality care initiatives. This lecture also discussed the considerations around who enters data and why efficient workflow and use of resources is required. Finally, this lecture discussed coding and both the legal and ethical issues related to proper coding.